Next, the world is under attack in X-Men First Class.
Christopher Plummer has a secret that stuns his son, Ewan McGregor, in Beginners.
6 months later, my father told me he was gay.
I'm gay.
Plus, a little treasure I found, the movie Submarine.
I'll think about it.
But what she meant was, yes, we are now as one.
Bad things tend to happen.
It's because you can't control it. It controls you. That's why we're here, Alex. That's why we're training.
Try higher frequency. Much higher.
That's a scene from one of the year's most anticipated movies, the latest in the X-Men series. I'm Christy Lemire of the Associated Press.
And I'm Ignatiy Vishnevetsky of Movie.com. Let's get to it. Roger's in his office with his review of X-Men First Class.
Most movies about comic book superheroes begin with the stories of their origins. X-Men First Class is the fifth film in the X-Men series and finally gets back to the beginning. This is Bill Curtis speaking for Roger Ebert. We meet the Nazi madman Sebastian Shaw, played by Kevin Bacon, who hopes to recruit mutants for his evil schemes.
So, you can stay, fight for the people who hate and fear you. Or you can join me and live like kings.
Against him is Charles Xavier, played by James McAvoy, who recruits young mutants to use their superpowers for good.
Banshee's got a location on shore. You ready for this?
Let's find out.
The story centers on Magneto, played by Michael Fassbender, who can control metal with his mind. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, Magneto actually turned missiles around in midair. Somehow this didn't make the history books.
There are thousands of men on those ships. They're just following orders.
I've been at the mercy of men just following orders. Never again.
I'm sorry, but the sight of those missiles shuttling back and forth struck me as hilarious. One of the most intriguing X-Men is Raven, played by Jennifer Lawrence, who is a shapeshifter.
There's a war coming, John.
Yes, but a war with who?
Excellent question. Though I wouldn't call it a war exactly. That suggests both sides stand an equal chance of winning.
X-Men First Class is competent weekend entertainment. The performances are good, the action is packed, and the noise is loud. As comic book movies go, it's better than Thor and not nearly as good as Spider-Man 2. I give it a marginal thumbs down.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Roger.
In our next film, Beautiful Boy, Michael Sheen and Maria Bello play a married couple who are on the verge of separating after 2 decades of marriage. The only thing they have in common is their son, who's a college freshman.
You sound a little tired. Are you getting enough sleep?
No, not really, but I'm gonna go to bed here in a minute. I have an early class in the morning, so.
Okay. But listen, it'll get easier. College is an adjustment.
And then one morning, that son takes a gun to school and opens fire on a classroom full of students.
We just lost our son. What do they want from us?
My news.
We are deeply sorry for the devastation our son has caused. We are shocked and utterly heartbroken.
Sheen and Bello hole up, first in her brother's house, then in a cheap motel, and find themselves needing each other more than ever as they try to come to terms with their son's actions.
We don't know why he did what he did. And I seem to be the only one that cares about asking why.
You keep asking why because you're looking for someone to tell us that we're not responsible.
Sheen and Bello managed to create a few raw moments of strong, real emotion in this movie, but they're few and far between. what we're left with is a story about a relationship that sometimes feels real between two people who never do. Thumbs down.
Thumbs down from me as well, for all the reasons that you say. This feels like a made-for-cable movie, like something timely. Like, here's a school shooting, mm-hmm. and here's how this normal suburban couple deals with it. But they are not drawn out at all. Neither is the son, and nor are his motivations. Perhaps it's intentional to allow us to project whatever we want onto them, mm-hmm. but the effect becomes, we just don't care. We don't get engaged. We don't feel compelled by them at all. Like, why feel for their struggle if they're not even real people?
Yeah, I mean, I understand kind of the reasoning for making the son kind of a separate, because it's really more about their marriage mm-hmm. than it is about the son. But at the same time, that has the effect of making, you know, their marriage seem incredibly vague. We don't really understand mm-hmm. why these people have been together. And though there are these almost cathartic moments mm-hmm. where Sheen and Bello kind of break through, and they manage to make it feel very raw and real. For the most part, the movie feels kind of contrived. It's yeah. very opaque.
But even those moments where they do have these great emotional breakdowns, mm-hmm. where they really tear into each other, I hate the way they're shot. Because there are all these swish pans and all these needless zooms. It's intentionally really artsy, and I think it really detracts from what is innately a very dramatic moment. You have really strong actors here doing some very raw work, and it gets all muddled up with the way it's shot.
Yeah, the color palette is very anemic. You know, it's yes. very drained of right. Drained of any color except for like gray and
it's
blue.
It's beige. It's very, very
and
beige.
The film itself is drained of emotion.
I yeah. agree. Next, Christopher Plummer, as you have never seen him before.
If Andy wasn't going to be monogamous, why should I be?
But first, here's a look at movies now playing in theaters.
Beginners stars Ewan McGregor as a guy who finds out his elderly father is dying of cancer. And it's a comedy, because at the same time, the father, played by Christopher Plummer, announces that he's gay. And now that his longtime wife, McGregor's mother, has died, he can finally reveal his true nature.
Yeah, they had some wonderfully loud
music. What kind of music's that?
Probably house music.
House music. Okay. House music.
McGregor's remembering his father in flashbacks, but at the same time, he's beginning his own new relationship, a quick and intense fling with a French actress played by Melanie Laurent.
And I found this crazy book.
That's kind of a classic American thing.
Maybe we can figure out some classic American things to do.
Beginners is absolutely charming. McGregor and Plummer have a lovely, natural chemistry.
That's your fatherly advice, personal ads.
Well, a lot of people use them. I did.
Now, a lot of this could have seemed too cutesy or cloying on paper. And since the basis of the story is autobiographical for writer-director Mike Mills, it could have been painfully self-indulgent. But it's not. It has great energy and hits just the right tone every time. Thumbs up from me.
This is cutesy and it's gimmicky, but it also comes from a genuine place. It's even more than being charming. It's touching and it has a tender side to it, especially in the relationship between Christopher Plummer and Ewan McGregor. Mm-hmm. More so than maybe in the relationship between Ewan McGregor and Melanie Laurent, which
but
I think
gets... He needs them both to change.
He needs them both, but that one I think veers a little bit too much into romantic comedy quirk.
Because of the way they meet at their little costume party where she can't speak mm-hmm. and she's got laryngitis and is writing little notes to him.
I mean, it's a very cute setup. Right, it could right. easily become grating. Mm-hmm. I think this is an example of, you know, three actors that do, though, manage to really overcome this. I mean, they really bring it across. There's something genuine in their performances, even when the situations that they're in are constantly artificial.
Right, Christopher Plummer's character, when he realizes he's gay, mm-hmm. there's no gay stereotype. He's not flamboyant. He's actually sort of vulnerable and like a kid all over again and trying to figure out who he is.
Yeah, and the film is very kind of sensitive towards this idea of a man trying to, you know, find himself in a different culture, you know, in a different role
he
in
has
the
to go
world
date.
Late in life. Yeah, the scenes with him dating, hanging out with friends are all really good. Well, most of the films we review on this show aspire to be works of prose. Our next film is a work of poetry, driven by images and ideas instead of plot or characters. It's film Socialisme, the latest by French New Wave icon Jean-Luc Godard. It begins on a Mediterranean cruise ship populated by detectives, luminaries, and war criminals.
Herr Obersturmbannführer Goldberg. Was machten Sie, Avenue Foch, en 1943?
Dégage, horrible gamin.
From there, film Socialisme spins out as a series of often unrelated situations, metaphors, and conversations, most of which circle back to themes of cultural heritage, obligation, and copyright.
Dans la manifestation, il y avait de la joie, du bonheur. Voilà le travail. À vous de jouer. Les soldats ont tiré dessus parce que manifeste. Et dans manifeste, il y a main.
I'll admit that many of you, our viewers, will probably find this film pretty baffling at first. That's fine. In fact, instead of tidily saying the end, the final image of the film says no comment. That's not a put-on. It's an invitation. It invites you to take the images and ideas of the film and make an interpretation of your own. Film Socialisme is one of the least manipulative films ever made. It becomes whatever you want it to be. I found the experience liberating.
I'm so happy that you're here. Because the whole time I was watching this, I was like, I can't wait for Ignatiy to explain to me why this is supposed to be good. Seriously, and you've watched it four times.
I've seen it four times.
The nuances, such as you say, how did you slog through it once? How did you watch it four times? I'm very baffled by this.
There's no boring film Socialisme. There's
only
a bored viewer.
No, it drags. It's these shots of nothing, of like overfed people on a cruise ship. And then I love how the best part of all, of course, is the subtitles, which are intentionally alienating. If you don't know French, he doesn't care because it's like a long sentence, and then beneath it will say German, Jew, Black. Like, she did not just say only three words. Seriously. What is his point? Is the degradation of European society?
Is it is that, not the is degradation that, of European
of
society.
I have
no
idea what the point of this movie is.
You are able to construct a point of your own. The subtitles are usually just series of nouns. You know, sometimes you get a verb
but
in there.
But why? Why do that? Why not make your point, whatever your message is, accessible to the people who are watching it? He is daring them to endure it.
First of all, this film is not that difficult. It's fairly simple.
I'm not stupid, and I had no idea what the hell he was trying to say.
It's got animals, you know.
Why is there a llama at the gas station?
Why shouldn't there be a llama at the gas station?
Is it all our own interior llama? Is that what that's about?
No, I think there's a llama at the gas station because he thinks llamas are funny. I think that's the only reason there's a llama at the gas station. But throughout, he kind of circles back to this thing about copyright, which has been a big point for him for just the last couple of years. And specifically being against copyright, being against this idea that authors own their work. And to me, this film and the subtitles are all about kind of letting go of that control and of that responsibility and handing it over to the viewer.
Let me ask you one more quick question.
Okay.
If you did not know Godard made this, if some random aspiring film student sent you a screener of this, would you be as wowed?
Well, that's exactly. An excellent... No, everything is about context. Everything is about context, and you and I both know this.
No, you worship Godard.
I would still think it's quite brilliant, but seen within the body of his work, that changes its meaning
He's
slightly.
He's a cranky old man ranting.
You are projecting a cranky old man onto this film.
It's what it is.
This is the film of a free man.
Okay,
that's
right.
What I see.
Well, you're wrong. My
I'm
hot
right.
Now pick is a documentary, Bobby Fischer Against the World. Speaking about ranting, it follows the rise and fall of the tormented chess genius who came from poverty in Brooklyn and reached the peak of his power and fame at 29 when he beat world chess champion Boris Spassky of the Soviet Union. The year was 1972, so the showdown was not just a competition, but a reflection of Cold War tensions that enraptured the world.
It was the Super Bowl. The audiences were gigantic. People stayed home from work.
People were lining up in front of TV sets and department stores. They were chess groupies.
On Times Square, they were showing the game live. It was that important.
Fischer was already eccentric and antisocial, but his victory pushed him over the edge. Director Liz Garbus tells Fischer's story in a pretty conventional way, with talking heads and newspaper headlines, footage of chess matches and old interviews with Fischer himself. But his story is so fascinating, weird, and sad, and Garbus has researched it so thoroughly, it's still extremely compelling. You can watch Bobby Fischer Against the World on HBO starting on Monday, June 6th.
Well, my pick for Hot and Now isn't a documentary, it's a mockumentary. It's The Troll Hunter, an imaginative low-budget adventure movie from Norway. A group of film students are shooting a documentary about bear poaching when they accidentally stumble upon the Troll Hunter, a man who works as a sort of game warden for Norway's population of mythical giants. He's played by comedian Otto Jespersen, who gets a lot of mileage out of playing this slayer of fairy tale beasts as an overworked, underpaid, and perpetually unfazed government employee. Every troll, after all, just means more paperwork and more cover-ups. Quickly paced and dryly funny, The Troll Hunter is a fine way to spend a summer evening. It's currently available on video on demand, and it will be playing in a few theaters around the country.
I need to check this out. It looks very fun and weird and clever and good. Our next movie is Submarine, a delightful little coming-of-age comedy. Now, those words, strung together in that order, ordinarily should make you cringe, but that won't be the case this time. Craig Roberts stars as Oliver, a misfit 15-year-old growing up in suburban Wales. One day, his dream girl, played by Yasmin Page, finally acknowledges him.
We kiss until our lips felt swollen. Her mouth tasted of milk, Polo mints, and Dunhill International.
At the same time, his parents, played by Sally Hawkins and Noah Taylor, are having trouble in their own relationship. They're both sort of emotionally distant when it comes to raising Oliver, but Mom tries to be supportive of his new girlfriend.
No, I am. I have a girlfriend now.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Of course. It's of course what I mean. Why wouldn't I didn't? I mean, I didn't.
Did you think
I was? No, I didn't come here. Oh.
Yes, writer-director Richard Ayoade probably borrows too heavily from Wes Anderson, especially from Anderson's Rushmore. But hey, if you're going to borrow, you may as well choose great source material. Thumbs up from me.
That you would choose a third-rate rip-off of early Jean-Luc Godard over the real thing.
But film socialism is not early Godard. They're totally different things.
I would argue that late Godard, even greater than early Godard. Yeah. This film, all of these references, and there's stuff not only from Godard and from Wes Anderson. There's a lot stolen from the 400 Blows. All these things, it's not form, it's not style, it's just fetishism. Nothing is being transposed, it's just being referenced. It's just like he's regurgitating these films that he's already seen.
It moves beautifully. It is shot and edited beautifully. There's some photography at the end of it when they're standing on the beach, which is absolutely gorgeous and beautiful in a very low-key way. And they're adorable together.
There's some good editing. I feel like some good editing was wasted on this film. Even the characters seem like gimmicks.
Nah, they're funny little weird misfit kids. I bought them together the whole time. They're very, very funny.
They don't seem like full characters.
You didn't like the mullet ninja guy?
The ninja psychic with the mullet is, you know, that's Gentleman Broncos level material.
I laughed every time he came on screen.
Well, Romania has been experiencing a movie renaissance in the last decade. What's become known as the Romanian New Wave plays freely with dark humor and social criticism. Our next film, Tuesday After Christmas, is no exception. It's about Paul and Adriana, an upper middle class married couple with a young daughter. The actors Mimi Brănescu and Mirela Oprișor are married in real life, and that gives an additional reality to the mundane interactions of their characters.
Îți vin?
Turnați. E bine că acum am pus să mă cătăr pe munți.
Uitați, asta e tot ce mai aveam, mai mică. Și ultima.
Mai căutăm.
Their life may seem comfortable, but Paul has been cheating on Adriana with their daughter's dentist, Raluca.
Știi că nu pot să merg.
Cum adică, mă? Sunt pe 23.
Da, Paul, sunt pe 23. E pe 23 să la Constanța.
Păi nu știi că te duci acum de ziua ei?
Ce fac, Paul? Mă frec pe drumuri în ajun de Crăciun? N-am cum.
Thing is that Paul loves Raluca and Adriana. Raluca knows Paul is married. Eventually, he's going to be forced to tell his wife about his mistress.
Ce-i drăguța cu tine?
N-am nimic.
Mă, tu mă minți. Ia uite ce încordat ești. Deci că ai înghițit un numeraș.
Tuesday After Christmas doesn't take sides. Instead, it's all about watching how these three characters navigate a situation that has no right answers. The director, Radu Muntian, constructs scenes out of unbroken takes that are all at least a few minutes long. That helps build not only the tension, and it gets very tense, but also the reality of these relationships. This movie is emotionally complex, it's completely unpredictable, and I can't think of a film I've seen this year that had three lead performances that felt more like real people than this one.
I would give it a thumbs up too, and I'm surprised to find myself saying that because I think the first hour of it is a bit of a slog, and that includes the 7-minute long single take at the very beginning where Paul and Raluca are extremely naked and very vulnerable. It's kind of riveting to spy on them, but so much of it is kind of mundane, going to the dentist's office to find out about her braces or whatever. But then you find that cumulatively, the effect sucks you in to the everyday reality of their lives. So when the big bombshell comes and it hits about an hour in, it's just devastating. And that's a long take too. And it's like, oh my God, what are they going to say next? I was riveted.
It really does help build not only the reality of it, it helps you understand the implications of, you know, the decision that they ultimately come to, because you become so familiar with what these people's lives really are like and what their relationships are like, not just on a basic, you know, plot level, but just on what the rhythms of their interactions are like, how they shop together, you know, how they sit around or have dinner together.
And there's no judging on anybody here. I mean, both women are lovely and interesting in very different ways. It's not like one is a shrew and one is awesome and young and beautiful.
No villains here.
No, not at all. And then there's a little girl whose life is at stake here too, and that's not played in any kind of heavy-handed ways. And yeah, it was surprisingly kind of lovely. I liked it. All right, earlier in the show, we reviewed the new movie X-Men First Class, but our correspondent Matt Singer takes a look at what he thinks is the most prophetic science fiction movie of the last 30 years, David Cronenberg's Videodrome.
When director David Cronenberg made Videodrome in 1983, there was no internet, cell phones, or streaming movie services. There was just television and videotape. And for our younger viewers, I should explain, this is a videotape. Ask your parents, they'll remember them. Despite the fact that VHS, Betamax, and basically all the technology in Videodrome is now totally outdated, the film itself remains as prescient as ever.
Videodrome is death.
Videodrome, now available in a stunning Blu-ray from the Criterion Collection, follows Max Wren, played by James Woods, the head of programming for a smutty cable access station who's looking to fill out his lineup of softcore pornography with something a little bit edgier. That's when one of his employees finds a pirate satellite signal for an underground television show called Videodrome.
D-R-O-M-E, Videodrome, like, you know, video circus, video arena. You know it?
No.
It's just torture and murder. No plot, no characters. Very, very realistic. I think it's what's next.
20 years later, the massive popularity of so-called torture porn films like Saw and Hostel, movies that make Videodrome look like Dora the Explorer, would prove Max absolutely right. And since the Videodrome signal actually causes brain tumors in anyone who watches it, you might even say that Cronenberg invented the very first, and most literal, viral video ever conceived. One of Videodrome's characters is a so-called media prophet named Brian Oblivion, who teaches Max about what Videodrome is and how it was created. And true to his title, Oblivion has some very prophetic things to say. Here's a sample of his philosophy.
The television screen has become the retina of the mind's eye.
Yes.
That's why I refuse to appear on television, except on television. Of course, Oblivion is not the name I was born with. That's my television name. Soon, all of us will have special names.
Oblivion and Cronenberg predicted everything from internet avatars to reality television to video chatting to cyber sex, to the pervasive paranoia that our cell phones might be giving us brain damage. The look of Videodrome is forward-thinking as well, predicting a world where TV screens are everywhere. And in 2011, you can watch television on your phone or in an airplane, even in an elevator. Cronenberg understood that TV is so seductive that many people would rather live on television than in the real world. Or, as Brian Oblivion put it, public life on television is more real than private life in the flesh. Give me a break, man. You're still on television right now. That's a good point.
Well, thank you so much, Matt. You know, I'm a huge fan of David Cronenberg's work. I feel like a really underrated side of it is just his way with actors, with lead actors. And James Woods is really good in Videodrome. Okay, recapping the films on this week's show. Thumbs down from Roger on X-Men First Class. Two thumbs down for Beautiful Boy. Two thumbs up for Beginners. Christy and I disagreed on film socialism. It was a very mild civil disagreement. We split again on Submarine. And two thumbs up on Tuesday After Christmas.
Join us next week for a special show, reviews of Super 8.
Action!
And the comedy, The Trip.
Don't you find it exhausting running around, chasing girls?
I don't chase them.
Oh, dear.
Plus our reviews of the big movies already in theaters.
Also, don't forget that you can join the discussion on Facebook and Twitter. Until then, the balcony is closed.
I got a confession to make. When Arnold Schwarzenegger's The Terminator opened in Chicago a couple of weeks ago, I gave it a pass. I figured a movie called The Terminator, this is probably not going to be one of the great masterpieces of the season. The Terminator is a really violent movie. It deserves its R rating. Don't go if you don't like violence. But as an exciting action picture, as an adventure picture, it's well enough made that I give it 3 stars, and I'm Roger Ebert.
For more reviews and more from Roger's office, visit our website at ebertpresents.com.